Good day. This is Minister Edward J. Robin of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption International. Today I've come before you to approach you as the detachment commander for the area Langford, Victoria, British Columbia. And this is to the man, the private man that I'm speaking of, and his family, that takes on the title as the sergeant of the RCMP, Larry Chomyn. And Larry, pictured here. Hello, Larry. You look like a pretty nice fellow, and I'm here to tell you I'm not much different. I'm fair, I'm honorable, and I'm honest. And I'm here to get an agreement with you, I guess warn you, and just familiarize you with what's going on with regards to 833 Arono Avenue and Ministers Carrie, Mary Helen, and Roderick Anthony of the Volk family. You may have been briefed about me with the old man, I guess I would call it, because in Christ I've given off the old man, that old name, Bélanger, that used to be attached to me. I find it to be a violation of my faith to attach to such a name, in consideration it was founded upon a fraud, a double fraud of a sort that's particular in nature to the fact that the man that named himself as my father and signed my mother's name on the birth certificate was not my father, and they were not married at the time that I was born. And that particular birth registration happened to be signed by a doctor in pencil. A very broad stroked pencil as well, graphite in those days. So the idea being is that men and women of faith, and this is where it seems to be a bit of a problem, because the RCMP is advised by some upper echelon hidden review committee, I guess, within the ASI, that would state that men and women of faith in Christ represent a threat and are frivolous and are harmful to the government of Canada, and that they are associated with terrorists and all kind of flagrant associations with words, kind of like a pseudo-linguistic method of making somebody look bad by applying a bunch of terms to them, when in reality you were just having men and women reading the King James Bible and following the words of Christ is defended by the Christian monarch that gives you your authority to wear a badge and a gun. The reality is that we have a corporation known as Canada that employs you. And Canada, if you were type it into the Dun & Bradstreet search engine, the United States Securities Exchange search engine under the companies, you can easily see that it is indeed a corporation that you work for. And that corporation is comprised of persons. These persons are indeed corporations as defined in Section 35 of the Interpretation Act, one of the laws in Canada that help you to do your job and enforce the various codes, regulations, statutes that go along with the interpretation of those words. That Section 35 contains the word person, and there you can get educated as to what that word means and the restrictions as to how far the application of that word goes. A person means a corporation. So I'm hoping that you will take my good faith and good-hearted and honorable effort here following the advice of Christ to heart. I'm hoping that this man, Larry, that I see here in the picture, will act in the honor that his family, I'm sure, holds in high regard. Because we are being intimidated as men and women in Christ in this sanctuary of Christ here at 833 Arono Avenue in Langford, British Columbia. We are being nuisanced and we are being obstructed in the ability to practice our faith and beliefs by the law firm Lawson and Lundell that's being run by private men and women, namely Kimberly and Robertson. Pardon me, Kimberly Robertson and Brian Gibbons, and there was another fellow here to mention of William Johnson, all using the guise of this law firm, Lawson and Lundell, and their bank, HSBC, and the directors thereof, to intimidate the private men and women, Mary, Carol, Helen, and Anthony Roderick of the Vogt family here to violate their newfound faith. When I say new, if somebody took it up 5 minutes ago and all of a sudden had a revelation that they'd been in bed with a false god, submitting themselves to the codes and regulations of a commercial nature created by a false god, and that they had to get out of that bed, that the respect for their faith and belief is again defended by that Christian monarch that gives you the authority to wear a badge and wear a gun. So the Cash 22 position is now, is you're going to be asked to help enforce some court order, which is huffing and puffing, and I have notified Christopher Hinkson, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of British Columbia, of the fraud that is taking place, utilizing Her Majesty's name on these courts to intimidate men and women of faith in Christ to violate their faith and to come before the false god of the court to have it decide a commercial nature which has been exposed as a fraud. The fraud of a mortgage, you may be interested to know, because you may hold your own mortgage. You may know many other members of the detachment that also hold mortgages, and they are being exposed to a fraud. Now, I wish to be charged with mischief and misleading people and making false statements if what I'm about to say is untrue. Because if you go into any banker and you ask him if that mortgage is a negotiable instrument worth the face value of funds stated on the instrument once it is signed, he will say, well, of course, it's a negotiable instrument. And yes, it is funds worth the face value of whatever it's stated. If it says $250,000 once the pen leaves the page, whoever is signing it, it's now turned into funds, a stack of money sitting there, only it's singular. It's like a bank draft. That then by law sent up to the Bank of Canada. You can read that in the Bank Act. And there for sure you see that the Bank of Canada then in turn has to exchange an equal amount of funds with equal negotiable instruments with indeed signatures upon them. Also pieces of paper. An equal value went up the hill and an equal value came down. That is not alone. Any group of intelligent monkeys sitting together could figure that one out. One's an exchange, the other is a loan. A loan is the bank must already be in possession of the funds before you arrive. And you're asking for a loan of the funds. The true state of the fact is the bank does not possess the funds and they need your negotiable instrument, the original funds, to negotiate the exchange. That is what's taking place across Canada, across the United States, and there have already been well over a dozen cases that have won in the courts proving that the bank could not produce the original instrument. It is because the bank has sold the original instrument and used it as a value so that they could float the loan. And also, in party to that, they have altered the names of the men and women on those instruments to reflect all capital versions of the name, as you'll find in obituary columns and in the graveyards, if you've ever had an opportunity to go. You will see that the tombstones are printed with all capital names, and upon asking the professions that represent these two instrumentalities, such as the newspapers in obituary columns and the graveyards, you will find out they will both tell you that's a formation for dead people's names. I am not dead. Neither are Carol, Mary, Helen, or Anthony Roderick, ministers of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption International, as slandered and defamed by Justice John Rooke of Canada. And this was after the fact that Terry Matchett, the Chief Justice of Alberta, disqualified seven judges because they had intimidated me to violate my faith in Christ, as witnessed by five witnesses. Those five witnesses signed off and complained to Terry Matchett, whom promptly disqualified those seven judges. His order, his decision, was based upon the witnesses' evidence. The trial took place and they were judged guilty and they were disqualified from ever sitting before me again. I believe now if you search on CPIC, you will see that I'm red flag, do not apprehend and do not detain. If I'm incorrect in that assumption, please get back to me and inform me, because I certainly don't want to spread about an opinion that may not be based upon accuracy. So my intent here, on behalf of Carol, Mary, Helen, and Roderick Anthony, ministers of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption International, here at 833 Arono Avenue, is to ask you if it's your intent to maintain a duty of care and a total honor of trust, rather than slip into a breach of that duty of care and a breach of trust. We are looking forward to an honorable reply that would indicate that no breach of trust will be taken upon and no breach of duty of care will be allowed to breach the sanctity of this, the sanctuary of Christ. Men and women worshiping Christ, no matter how young and on the milk in their faith, must be afforded that opportunity in a Christian monarchy where you have one sworn to defend the laws of God with all of her power sitting on the throne. Anything less than this is subjecting itself to the assumption of treason. This is very serious why I am contacting you. I have been intimidated, I have been jailed, I have been put down, maligned, and lied about. Because of my faith in Christ represents a threat to the commercial system that the judges, the lawyers, and the prosecutors, and even yourself, as an employee of the Government of Canada, as a commander of the RCMP, must be aware of. This represents a massive conflict of interest. You're put into a position where you're being asked by your employer to intimidate men and women in Christ to violate their faith and submit to a false god of a corporate entity called a bank, engaging a law firm called Lawson and Lundell to do the dirty work of the intimidation. These directors of this bank are guilty of intimidation 423 of the Criminal Code. They're guilty of nuisance 180, and they're guilty of 176, obstructing the ministry of the men and women of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption International. This breach of trust 336 of the Criminal Code brings about a serious observation as to why Section 45, treason, becomes applicable. Every man and woman in Canada has been delegated by the judges that felt threatened that they only have 2 weeks, according to the Criminal Code, to place a complaint about treason. This situation, Larry, is about that complaint. These men and women for the law firm of Lawson and Lundell are engaged in treason to bring down Her Majesty's ability to live up to her coronation oath and defend the faith, and they, sworn allegiance to that Christian monarch herself, are as double-faced as they come. How can you have an oath of allegiance to a Christian monarch who herself in one duty installed and caused to be defender of the Christian faith, fide-eye defensor, go and intimidate other men and women that wish to practice their faith in Christ and not submitting to the codes of a false god? How can that seem logical to you? How can any integrity and honor be applied when that's taking place? How can you submit yourself to saying that you stand as an honorable member of the RCMP when now you're aware this is taking place? I put to you that you must investigate my claims for the honor to prevail. For I say to you, when you do investigate these claims, you will see that they are real, that they are true, and there is no fault in my assertions that Carol, Mary, Helen, and Roderick Anthony, and all the ministers of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption International are feeling quite intimidated, nuisanced, and obstructed in their ministry by the arrogant attitudes of some of these men and women acting as lawyers, justices, and even Supreme Court justices, that have disgust for the fact that we would dare stand up and exercise our faith in Christ to say we can't be held responsible for your errors, lies, and deception and fraud. We cannot be bound to submit to your fraud, as extortion is not part of your lawful ethic. Now, these are pretty heavy words that I'm saying to you as a commander of the RCMP. I'm not speaking to you as a criminal. I'm speaking to you as a minister of Christ. Unless you have first-hand evidence that I am a criminal, I advise you to contact Sergeant John Hanley. John Hanley used to work in the Neepawa detachment, and he stopped me once and took away my church set of wheels. I think it was a 91 Cadillac at the time. And he contacted Alan Bennett of the Solomon Lodge in Kamsack, Saskatchewan, and they had quite the discussion, both being of the Brotherhood of Freemasons. And Alan, knowing me quite well, not being a brother, not wishing to be doctrinated into the Brotherhood, but knowing me as a man of knowledge and study, respecting me, asked John Hanley what he was going to do with my car. And John Hanley said, well, I need to know what your friend's going to do with his contention that I violated 176 of the criminal code, because the prosecutor has told me that he can't defend me if your friend charges me with that because I broke the law. This is the private attaché and defense for the Queen when she comes to Canada, John Hanley. And the prosecutor told him, because he instructed me, took away my car, and interfered with my ability to carry on my ministry, that he had no ability to defend him because he had violated the law. And John Hanley was worried and seriously considered in resigning the force, because if I charged him before he resigned, he would lose his pension, because he was inextricably in a position of violating the criminal code. John Hanley is a man to speak to, and I invite you to speak to him, because I told him I have no maliciousness in my heart. Give back the church property, and I'm not going to charge you. Alan Bennett, acting as the, envoy for the church, and a minister of the church indeed, did offer his assistance and let John Hanley know I had forgave him and I had no intent to bring him into dishonor, and he had no need to resign from the force. He transferred to the Northwest Territories. So I'm telling you that story, I guess some would call it name dropping, but I'm not doing it as that. I'm doing it so you can have a point of reference. So maybe you can contact Alan Bennett. He's a member of the Solomon Lodge, a 33rd degree Mason, a Knights Templar, and a Shriner. I think the honor of his position might interest you when he tells you who I am, and that I am not an imposter and a fraud and a terrorist, that some of the so-called reports by your agency, the Brotherhood of the RCMP, have put out about myself and the church. These are malicious attempts in damage control to ensure that the faith and beliefs in Christ do not spread too rapidly, and too many people find out that they've been subjected to slavery, and they can escape that slavery simply by gaining the agreements that Christ informed them of. So I hope you will check out what I've had to say here, and I hope you will observe that Justice Rook was doing damage control when he wrote that 182-page Meads versus Meads decision, and that Justice Rook just happens to be quite close friends with the fellow that married my cousin. I'm sure he didn't know it at the time that Brent Phillips was married to my cousin, but my cousin's a lawyer in Courtney, British Columbia, and she's aware of what's going on too and bears witness. So my effort here is good-hearted. There is nothing malicious in men and women having their ability to practice their faith in Christ without feeling fearful, intimidated, obstructed, and nuisanced in their ability to do so in their choice of sanctuary and temple, 833 Orono Avenue. So I'm asking for you to investigate these serious allegations that this law firm out of Vancouver has gone and stepped over the line, and this is not to assign to the Commercial Crimes Unit, so we sit 2 years waiting for something to be done while they continue in their efforts to intimidate, obstruct, and be a general nuisance to the Ministry of Christ. No, this is for an examination of criminal activity based upon a breach of trust, based upon treason, nuisance, obstruction, and intimidation. So I thank you so much, Larry, for you taking the time to hear about this serious matter, and that you now, formally noticed and in awareness, can take the time to avoid the assumptions that you may have been forced to rely upon before you got a chance to meet me here on YouTube. And I'm hoping to meet you man to man, face to face, so we can further discuss this and you can see that the intent and honor in the hearts of the men and women of the Church of Ecumenical Redemption, namely Carol, Mary Helen, and Roderick Anthony, is sincere. There is nothing fictitious or made up or trying to escape anything other than evil and seductive corruption. That is the only thing these men and women are trying to escape, and I expect your honor in reply to aid us to cease the fear and the agony of knowing that there are men so vile and women so corrupt that they will do anything to force men and women in Christ to give up their faith. Thank you again for the time and the opportunity to speak with you, and may God bless. Bye for now.